This lecture is all about the structure of the sun. We'll learn why the sun shines so brightly, and we'll define and describe the layers of our sun's atmosphere and interior. Ancient people, and unfortunately some modern ones too, imagined the sun to be on fire. The idea of the sun being fueled by burning of coal or wood was ruled out by the mid-1800s. Calculations showed that the chemical burning could not possibly account for the sun's huge output of energy. By the late 1800s, astronomers came up with the idea that the sun generates energy by slowly contracting in size. This gravitational contraction would, in theory, keep the inside of the sun hot and the outside shining steadily for up to about 25 million years. This seemed reasonable, but geologists pointed out a big problem. Rocks and fossils had already shown that the Earth was far older than 25 million years. With both chemical processes and gravitational contraction ruled out, a completely new type of explanation was needed, and it came with Einstein's publication of his special theory of relativity in 1905. Einstein's theory included his famous discovery of E equals mc squared. This equation tells us that mass itself contains an enormous amount of potential energy. Calculations immediately show that the sun's mass contained more than enough energy to account for billions of years of sunshine. By the end of the 1930s, it was clear. The sun converts mass into energy through the process of nuclear fusion. Nuclear fusion requires enormous temperatures and densities. Therefore, the sun's core must be very hot. And it is. Our sun formed about 4.5 billion years ago from a collapsing cloud of interstellar gas. As this cloud collapsed, it became hotter and hotter. Eventually, temperatures in the core became hot enough to sustain nuclear fusion, and our sun officially became a star. The sun continues to shine steadily today because it has two kinds of balance that keeps its size and energy output stable. The first kind of balance is called gravitational equilibrium. This is the balance between the outward push of internal gas pressure and the inward pull of gravity. The sun's internal pressure balances gravity at every point within, keeping the sun stable in size. Because the weight of the overlying layers is greater as we look deeper into the sun, the pressure must increase with depth. The second kind of balance is the energy balance between the rate at which fusion produces energy in the core and the rate at which the sun's surface radiates this energy into space. If fusion in the core did not replace the energy that gets radiated away from the surface, then gravitational contraction would cause the sun to shrink and its core temperature would rise rapidly. This doesn't happen. Although the temperature of the core does increase slowly over time for reasons we'll discuss later, our sun is essentially a stable star. Our sun shines so brightly because 4.5 billion years ago, its gravitational contraction made the sun hot enough to sustain nuclear fusion in its core. Ever since, the energy released by fusion has maintained gravitational equilibrium and energy balance within the sun, keeping it shining steadily. The sun was born with enough hydrogen in its core to maintain this equilibrium for about 10 billion years. The sun is therefore only about halfway through its 10 billion year lifetime. About 5 billion years from now, when the sun finally does use up its nuclear fuel, gravitational contraction will take over and some very interesting things will happen. We'll talk all about the death of the sun later in the semester. Our sun is made up almost entirely of hydrogen and helium. And it is enormous. We could fit 109 Earths across its diameter. On the sun's surface are dark spots called sunspots. The sun is not a solid sphere. Different parts of it rotate at different rates. The equator is fastest with a rotation period of about 25 days. At the poles, it's 30 days. Finally, the sun releases an enormous amount of energy, only a small fraction of which reaches Earth. Our sun is basically a sphere of ionized atoms. The different temperatures and densities at different depths give the sun a layered structure. We'll take a very brief look at each of these layers now. Let's start with the outermost layer and work our way in. First, we have the solar wind. This is the stream of charged particles, mostly protons and electrons, that are continually being blown outward from the sun. Closer to the sun is the corona. The corona is the halo of plasma that surrounds the sun. It stretches millions of kilometers into space. Below the corona, nearer to the sun's surface, is the chromosphere. Here, the temperature drops suddenly from about 1 million Kelvin to 10,000 Kelvin. The chromosphere is the region that radiates most of the sun's X-ray light. Below the chromosphere is the photosphere. This very thin layer is the lowest layer of the atmosphere and the visible surface of the sun. It's far less dense than Earth's atmosphere, and it has a temperature of about 5,800 Kelvin. If you could somehow fly into the sun's atmosphere, you would be able to look back and see the stars through the layers until you reach the photosphere. Once you're below the photosphere, you're completely engulfed inside the sun. Under the photosphere is the turbulent layer known as the convection zone. This is where energy generated in the solar core is transported upward by the rising of hot gas and the falling of cool gas. Below the convection zone is the calmer radiation zone, where energy moves outward primarily in the form of light. The temperature rises to almost 10 million Kelvin in this region, and there are intense X-rays. The innermost part of the sun is the core. It is the source of the sun's energy. In the core, nuclear fusion transforms hydrogen into helium. It is very hot and very dense. We'll discuss the details of what's happening within the solar core in the next lecture. That's all for now. Take care. I'll talk to you again soon.